Hello, greetings and welcome. Alexander Azadgan here, editor at large with United World International. We just got off air on a very interesting podcast that also includes visual with Professor Jim Fetzer, along with Scott Bennett from Revolution Radio. It was a very, very interesting two-hour conversation. We will post the video for you guys here in my YouTube channel for you to benefit. It was a three-way conversation between me, Professor Emeritus, Jim Fetzer. A man is a legend. You should just Google him and read his Wikipedia page. It's absolutely amazing. Along with the new William Wallace, known as Scott Bennett, the incredibly courageous whistleblower who served time for his honesty, for actually doing his job and appearing before Congress. He actually served prison time. A frequent guest on Press TV, RT, Sputnik, among other alternative global media outlets. Our conversation revolved around Ukraine and Russia to a great extent, and how these two countries' fates is somehow interlinked with President Trump's presidency, especially at a time where he's only a month away, a year away from the presidential elections. It's the beginning of October here, and our election, as you're aware, our presidential election or any of our election for our global audience, those who are wondering, is always on the first Tuesday of November. Now, why did the founding fathers choose the first Tuesday of November? That's because they were elitists. They didn't want it to be on a weekend where everybody could go vote. And Tuesday is literally a day after the start of the work week, and people would not be interested to going to polls and voting, except those who are very politically conscious. So they picked this Tuesday, not just accidentally, it was for a reason. At any rate, the discussion revolved around the potential criminal behavior of Mr. Trump and the way he was trying to dig up dirt on his political opponent, in this case, Joe Biden, the former vice president under President Obama for 8 years. He seems to be the front runner, although if you ask me, I'm always at awe how the Democrats are such experts at nominating a person who's going to lose. Regardless of how you feel about Mr. Trump, he had a zeitgeist of what is going on in America. He had his hand on the pulse of America. And the Republicans, even though they never liked Mr. Trump, after all, they never thought he's a real Republican, nominated him among a pool of many other qualified Republicans because they knew he's going to win the elections. And all that matters to Republicans is winning elections so they can enact their own hawkish policies when it comes to foreign policy, as well as a very anti-government, anti-entitlement, which is their word, social policies and economic policies within the United States. And here we are again, another election on the way, and Mr. Trump is going to go unchallenged within his own party, and he's most likely is going to get elected again, unless the Democrats dig up some major dirt on him and somehow the impeachment is going to be implemented. Although if you ask me, my prediction, my academic prediction, is that no matter what they throw at this character, Donald Trump, he's somehow going to survive. He is a belligerent person who would like to win at any cost, even in this case, quite possibly soliciting another head of state from another part of the world to dig up dirt on his opponent. On the same token, Mr. Trump's people are saying that the economic relationship between Mr. Biden and Ukraine is so absolutely corrupt that it outdoes anything Trump may have done in wanting to get dirt on Mr. Biden. And they're going to Biden's son. The fact that at some point he received $50,000 a month for some of the deals that were being made between some companies here in the United States that the Joe Biden and his faction had a hand in with the government of Ukraine. Why is this so important at a time like this? At a time when Democrats are encouraging a spirit of paranoia and panic toward Russia and embracing Ukraine as the country that's standing up to Russia. I can go right into the point with you guys from an international political economic perspective. It's because tremendous amounts of natural gas and oil have been discovered in Western Ukraine, and the entire country of Ukraine has been flirting with European Union in wanting to become and possibly a member of European Union, and worse than that, becoming a member of NATO. This is a clear and present danger for the Russians and their regional interest. After all, the historical ties between Ukraine and Russia have go back so far that at many points, Kiev, the city of Kiev, was more important than even Moscow itself when it comes to the Russian sphere of influence. We are talking 1,000 years ago. So, with the discovery of natural gas and petroleum in western parts of Ukraine, this created a perfect opportunity for a transatlantic alliance, particularly Washington, to take advantage of this division that was developing between Ukraine and Russia in order for both of those countries to capture the European energy market, for Washington to come in, for all these American oil companies to come in and invest and what have you, in order to make Europe a client, a purchaser of the Ukrainian oil and natural gas. Now, why would they be interested in doing that and risking the wrath of Russia? Well, those of you who are students of contemporary history are well aware that several years ago, Russia actually turned off the pipelines for Europeans not to receive natural gas, which is the a preliminary form of energy for Europeans to heat up their homes. And in many cases, Europeans froze, literally. This was a Kremlin mafia diplomacy at its worst, if you want to take the sides of the Europeans. At any rate, from that point on, the Germans, who are the most, the strongest country in the European Union, decided to diversify their source of obtaining energy, not to be over-reliant on Russia, and diversify between Russia and Ukraine and Middle East, where they get a significant amount of their natural gas, as well as us here in the United States. Although we send our natural gas not through pipelines, but obviously because of geography, we send it through these huge oil ships. So having the pipeline in place between Europe and Russia ensured a very cheap way of maintaining energy and obtaining energy from Russia. All that is changing now. Germany is once again, after seeing how Russia stood up for its national interest in Ukraine, is allying itself to Russia, and hence we have this incredible pipeline going from Russia to northeastern part of Germany called Nord Stream 1 and Nord Stream 2. They build these pipelines from the Russian city of Vyborg, northwest of St. Petersburg, all the way on the under the Baltic Sea, parts of it going along the land between Russia and Finland, and then going all the way under the Baltic Sea to this German northeastern port, whose name I don't recall at the moment. So we are looking at major shaping and shifting of energy geopolitics between Europe and Russia, between Europe and Ukraine, and between Europe and the United States. Those of you who recall, Donald Trump, several months ago on one of his visits to Europe, actually sat down with Chancellor Merkel, Angela Merkel, and in a very vocal, public way, expressed his dissatisfaction for the Germans going back and going to Russia to get their natural gas instead of obtaining it from us, from the United States. And Mr. Trump, in his a typical bullyish way, said, "After all, we have been defending you from the Russians during the past 70, 80 years since the end of World War II, and you should be buying it from us instead of buying it from the Russians, whom we have been protecting you from." Now, of course, this comes in handy. Washington always needs an enemy, a boogeyman, whether it's Russia or Iran in the Middle Eastern region, or China, whose economy is rapidly rising, in order to justify their over $700 billion a year Pentagon budget. That doesn't mean China is not an existential threat economically and quite possibly down the decades militarily to United States. It is. That doesn't mean that Russia is not an enemy of United States. It could be. But the multipolar world that we are trying to create should be based on mutual understanding, beneficial sharing of resources, multipolarity of economic and socio-political power, instead of a unipolar world arrangement that we've been having since the fall of the Soviet Union since 1991. The global community needs to evolve and mature to a level where one country doesn't get to bully others, as we have been doing more or less since the fall of the Soviet Union. The way we federalized and we tore up Yugoslavia into four or five countries and ravaged that country by our involvement in Yugoslavia. Why Yugoslavia? In all Eastern European countries, Yugoslavia was the most militaristically and economically viable countries aligned with Russia. None of the other countries were that much in alliance with Russia. Not Czech Republic, not Slovakia, not Poland, not Romania, not Bulgaria. There was always a Slavic connection between Russia and Yugoslavia, and before that, it was Serbia. Those of you again who are students of history recall that World War I began where a Serbian nationalist assassinated Archduke Ferdinand, who was the crown prince of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which consisted a lot of these Central European and Eastern European countries. That was huge, and that was one of the reasons why the Europeans went to war against each other. Germany against Russia, Russia against everybody else, and then Germany against everybody else, against Britain and France. So Serbia and later Yugoslavia is where we went in under President Clinton and exerted the American power. And then, when that country came apart, a lot of the policymakers in Washington were clapping that here we go, we dismantled Russia's closest ally in Eastern Europe. Ever since that time, the unipolarity of the world order has exacerbated to a point where we have become unbelievable, out of control bullies. And that has manifested in the personage of none other than Donald Trump. Interestingly, Donald Trump did not want an economic and political and quite possibly a militaristic war with Russia. The Democrats did. All the Russia phobia that you observe in your mainstream media, which you shouldn't watch in the first place unless you enjoy being lied to, is because Russia wants to have its own independent destiny among nations of the world. It doesn't want to be second-rated to United States as it had been until the coming to power of Mr. Putin. And for most part, the first half of the first decade in the 21st century, they want to have an independent foreign policy like they used to in Soviet Union, and they see many countries in the area as their sphere of influence. Ukraine, they see it as a sphere of influence. As a matter of fact, the entire formation of the Eurasian Economic Union, better known as EA/EU, is based on bringing a lot of these countries from the former Soviet Union together and quite possibly create their own currency. This is very, very dangerous to the supremacy of the petrodollar system of US and Saudi Arabia. So now, through this analysis, you're beginning to put two and two together and understanding the very complex relationships of these geopolitical powers. At any rate, all of this is seeping into the internal US politics. Mr. Trump having so many skeletons in his closet, and up to this point, the Democrats exploiting the quite possibly this neuro-linguistic programming brainwashing phrase of the Russian intervention in our election, which their own people could not prove, and Mr. Trump didn't get exonerated, but he was scot-free. He wasn't criminally indicted when it comes to that. Now they're going after, the Democrats are going after Ukraine's relationship with Mr. Trump when it comes to Mr. Trump spying on his domestic opponents vis-a-vis the information that Ukraine has. Now, Ukraine has all sorts of dirt on Joe Biden, like I said, because a lot of Democrats, and not just Joe Biden and his son, had very lucrative business relationship with that country. Very lucrative. And so both sides have their evidence to neutralize each other, the Democratic side as well as Mr. Trump's side. And this is how complex the entire atmosphere is getting in the United States. Now, in order for Mr. Trump to be actually impeached, he needs 67 senators to be on the side of the Democrats. And as you're aware, the Senate is predominantly Republican now. I don't think their Democrats are going to have 67 votes, which means quite a few senators, right? Quite a few senators, more than 17 actually, to be on the Democratic side, Republican senators. We don't forecast that happen. Like I said, after Nixon, the Republicans came up with this attitude that never again will a Republican president be allowed to be impeached. So all of this is more and more politicking in our domestic affairs with a nuance, with a degree of international flavor, in this case, Ukraine and Russia. So we'll have to see what happens. I personally don't predict Mr. Trump is going to be impeached or that he would be disallowed to run in next year's election. Unfortunately, my colleagues and I forecast Mr. Trump to win next year's election, maybe not with such a narrow margin, maybe not with an overwhelming margin, as was the case with our electoral college system in many of these red states, but perhaps with a narrower margin and still getting into power. There are many huge interests behind him that want him in power, including the Israelis. It's quite possible Russians may prefer for him to be in power, but as far as Russian interference in our election, that is something that didn't come to be proven. And also, let me add this here. What about our intervention in everybody else's elections? Especially if our national interests sort of swayed us to interfere in those countries' elections. We have been doing that since the end of World War II, when we became an empire. So there's this spirit of absolute hypocrisy when it comes to this neurolingual programming, brainwashing phrase of Russian intervention in our elections. Like literally five words that keeps getting repeated in the media, or has been repeated in the media for the past 3 years. Manufacturing consent against Russia in the minds of American voters, thinking they actually interfered. Now, Mr. Trump, as I mentioned earlier, has had a very interesting relationship with Russia in terms of the Russian mob. Nobody's lending money to Mr. Trump. Nobody has been for a long time, not even the Chinese. A lot of the beef he had against the Chinese during his campaign season is because even the Chinese didn't lend them money. After all, the Chinese are lending money to everybody, including the African nations. But the only people who lend them money were these Russian gangsters, right? The Russian mafia. And those of you who are students of Russian politics know that there's always been a very strange relationship between Kremlin and the Russian oligarchs. The Russian oligarchs had a major role in putting President Putin in power, and then Mr. Putin very shrewdly got rid of some of them, and some of them were exiled to Britain, and some of them were just completely their wealth was taken away and their influence was taken away. So that goes to say the tactics and the shrewd methods of Mr. Putin. At any rate, we'll have to see where these investigations take us. It's very interesting. Very, very interesting for the domestic audience. It's almost like a soap opera when you turn on CNN or MSNBC and watch what's going on. There's all these characters that happen like in a typical American soap opera. At any rate, I hope you enjoy this analysis and the geopolitical implications of this possible corruption case of Mr. Trump or Mr. Biden, both of them with the Ukrainians, and we'll have to see where the investigations take us. Thank you so much for your support, and as always, keep the faith alive. Thank you.